Okay, so off we go. Hello, everyone. Wonderful to see so many people with us today. And welcome to the Stitching Together Good Practice Guidelines launch. I am Emma Shercliff, and together with my colleague Amy, Amy Twigger Holroyd, who's waving there. I'll just wave here. I'm Emma. And there's wavy, Amy waving. We lead the Stitching Together Research Network. It's a real pleasure to see so many people here. They're still coming. to see so many people here with us this afternoon and from so many different places. This is, of course, the huge advantage of online events, that we can include so many people who wouldn't otherwise be able to join us. People are still joining us. They come. Just a quick word, please do use the chat. I know you've already started using it, but use the chat to say hello to everyone and let us know where you're joining us from. Otherwise, this event is conceived as a very informal get together, really to mark the launch of the Good Practice Guidelines and offer an opportunity to meet some of the contributors, albeit on screen, but it's wonderful to have so many people with us and still come. So we're very grateful to all the contributors to the Good Practice Guidelines, and especially to our speakers this afternoon, who have agreed to talk very briefly about the projects that are featured in the publication. So Amy and I will very briefly introduce the Stitching Together Network and the guidelines, and then hand over to the speakers. We aim to wrap up the session by about 5 p.m., but we are keeping the meeting open beyond that. The idea being to allow for continued sharing and discussion, an after party of sorts, if you like, for any of you who wish to carry on. So still people coming, and so for those of you who might be new to the Stitching Together Research Network, a super, super brief introduction now to the work that we're doing. The Stitching Together Research Network brings together researchers, professional textile practitioners, project commissioners, and enthusiast textile maker groups to develop improved critical understandings of participatory textile making. And by that, we mean making textiles with others in a group, in a community setting, and so on. But also the network aims to offer opportunities to share experiences, ideas, and opportunities. The project is funded by the UK's Arts and Humanities Research Council. So, all additional information, please do head over to the website. Amy's showing it to us now to find out more. And I'll leave it there for now. Amy, I will hand over to you and let more people in.
Excellent. Okay. Let me click to the next slide. Okay, so I'm just going to talk a little bit about the guidelines. So this is this document that we're launching today, and we're so pleased to have so many of you here to kind of celebrate with us. So the overall aim of the guidelines is to provide advice for people who facilitate participatory textile making workshops and projects. So that might be professional textile practitioners, artists, academic researchers, people working in museums and galleries, community activists, amateur enthusiasts who want to organise something with their friends, or anyone else. So really anybody who wants to organise some kind of textile making project or workshop. So we're really, really conscious, I mean, already from our own experiences, but very much from the people that we're in touch with, we're so conscious that textile making workshops and projects can take so many different forms, and they're organised in such a diversity of contexts. there's, you know, it's just such a multiplicity of amazing activity. So we've tried very hard to create a flexible resource that can be adapted as needed for all of these different kind of variables. So just to explain a little bit about how this document has come about, it's been quite a long time in development. Emma and I have been dreaming of this kind of document, this kind of advice for years, since we met and discovered our shared experiences of running textile workshops and projects as kind of professional designers, makers, facilitators. And then we were both incorporating these activities into our PhD research. So we had a hunch that others might have the same need. And so we planned the development of the guidelines as part of the network's activities when we were applying for the funding. So then we got the funding and we started started up the network and started working together more intensively. So we generated initial ideas at a network event back in April 2019 and then took it further, kind of added some detail at a second event in June of the same year. It sat for a while, but then I kind of picked it up and spent some time looking around and seeing what relevant advice I could find from other sources that would be kind of relevant to our context of textile making, and found some amazing things, many of which are signposted in the document itself as further reading. But kind of developed it into a draft, and then we invited network members to contribute comments on several versions of the draft in the summer of this year. And then to kind of bring the work to life, we wanted to include images of projects, and 15 network members also kindly allowed us to use images of their projects within the publication. So altogether, and as indicated here in the acknowledgements, the publication is built on the contributions of over 40 people, and we're deeply grateful to all of them. It's really something that I don't think any one of us could have come up with this by itself. And I'm certainly very conscious of kind of how many things came in beyond the first draft that I put together and how much I learned just by kind of steering its development. So this diagram, conceived to look somewhat crochet-like, sums up the guidelines as a whole. So it's a kind of visual overview. So the whole document is based around four principles: informed participation, maximal benefit with minimal risk, inclusivity based on mutual respect, and appropriate planning and resourcing. So they're the kind of four principles that underpin and kind of run through everything. And then the guidelines themselves are split into eight sections, each of which is neatly split into three subsections. And these eight sections, the eight main sections, sort of roughly follow the trajectory of a project or workshop from the initial ideas, when you're just getting started, all the way through to the aftercare, kind of remembering to plan for what happens at the end. Or as Emma and I would often discuss, the bin bag of stuff that you might be left over with at the end of a project and working out what you meant to do with it. So this is how the diagram appears in the document. And as you'll see, as we click through the pages when we're showing the speakers' projects, each of these sections is expanded over a few pages. And you know, there's a lot of detail for each one of these sections. But this summary is kind of useful as an overview of the issues and the considerations that we're highlighting. And then, you know, with this flexibility in mind that I'm kind of emphasizing, the facilitator, the person using this document, can decide where they might want to dip in for more detail. And that's kind of there. So it's intended to be used in a kind of flexible way. Okay, I think back to you now, Emma.
Okay, so now we're going to talk to some of the contributors to the Good Practice Guidelines, and really for them to give us a very brief glimpse into the projects and the work featured in the guidelines. So we're going to start with our first speaker. Our first speaker is Catherine Reinhart. Fittingly, her work is on the front cover, and Catherine is joining us from the US. So Catherine, over to you. I can't see you, but I know you're there.
Hello.
Would you like to tell us a bit about this project? There you are, I can see you now. Wonderful.
Yes, I would love to, and thank you so much. First of all, I am so excited to be a part of the Stitching Together Research Network and to have this really beautiful image. I love this image and that you chose it for the cover. I feel so honored. So thank you so much. I am Catherine Reinhart, and I'm an interdisciplinary artist who works with fiber and social practice in Ames, Iowa, USA. And so my project is called the Collective Mending Sessions, and it's a series of socially engaged workshops that center around collectively mending abandoned quilts. And also the important question of the project is a metaphorical one: how do we mend our communities? And so briefly, a session would look like this. In the before times when we could meet together in person, each session would be 2 to 3 hours. And the first hour would be introductions and instructions. And these would be instructions in basic textile care and sort of basic mending. So darning, patching, some basic embroidery, stitches. And then the last half of the session would be for discussion around that larger question of how do you mend your community, and just community building through socializing and sort of directed conversation. The genesis for this whole project was an abandoned quilt from when I was a teenager. And I told my mom to throw this quilt away. And of course, she's more wise than I, and she did not do that. And she kept it and gave it back to me about 3 years ago. And I knew I needed to repair it. It was really torn apart. And it was a queen size quilt. So once I started to patch and darn it, I quickly realized I can't do this by myself. And so the collecting mending session was born when I asked people to come and stitch alongside of me. Since then, I've held 20 sessions at over 10 locations locally in my community, and then nationally around the US. And I've had 100 plus sewers add their stitches to two quilts that we've worked on. And actually during the pandemic, I've also shifted and we're doing a virtual mending session, and I have cut up a quilt and sent it out even as far as Malta. So, and then we get together and we stitch on Zoom. So I'm just gonna briefly share two testimonials from participants. One gal I'm gonna read, Susan, I saw her in the room, so that's exciting. And Susan said, the collective mending sessions are uplifting, meditative, and collegial gatherings. I relish the opportunity to add my stitches to those made by others, and also the lively and meaningful conversations that ensue. And then I'll just read my favorite answer to the question, how do you mend your community, was from a participant from a workshop in this past January, right before we shut down for the pandemic. And it's almost prophetic in its timeliness. So she said, to mend your community, you recognize that mending is not making something as it was before. Rather, mending is taking something that has been broken and making it useful again. So in order to mend a community implies that it is broken. And if it is broken, then only parts need to be removed and replaced with something new, woven in with the whole old to create something whole again. And Emma and Amy asked this question in an email. They said, how will you use this resource? And I want to say, I wish I had this resource 3 years ago when I started these mending sessions, and it would have helped tremendously with grant writing, with reporting, with getting funding, you know. And I'm so excited to pass it along to, I had several people in different sessions tell me, I want to do something similar in my own town. Here's my idea. How do I do it? And I wish I could have, you know, and now I'll just give them your guide. Oh, this is where you begin, you know. It's so extensive. And also I'm just gonna pass it along to people who are doing social practice. I know a few in programs in the US and my textile artists and friends. And then I'm a part of, I'm on staff with the Surface Design Association, which is a international fiber arts organization, but they really have an extensive network that includes museums and educators in textile programs. And so I'm hoping to share that with them. And so that can, you know, just spread it out over a larger network than I have. So,
Catherine, that's a really an amazing plug. Thank you.
Yeah. Well, thank you for letting me talk. And that's all I got. You can see the project. It's just collectivemendingsessions.com. And I think you shared where you can find that. So thanks so much.
Thank you, Catherine. Wonderful. And next in our line of speakers, we have Lynn Setterington. Lynn has a very extensive body of work that many people this afternoon will be familiar with. And she has contributed very generously to the guidelines. Four projects are featured. So over to you, Lynn, to tell us something about your work.
Hi there. Hi. Can everybody hear me? Yeah.
Yes, we can.
Good. Hello. Well, yeah, nice to see everybody. And what a great turnout. So I'm in Manchester. And I've been stitching together for a long, long time, 25 years. So it's kind of great to kind of see this kind of coming together. And, you know, the guidelines, I think will be used in lots of different ways and fabulous to have. I'm just going to very quickly talk about the project, the Respect and Protect project that's down on the bottom left there of the screen, the red and white quilt. It was made for World AIDS Day in 2009. So it was actually my birthday as well. It's next Tuesday. So I thought I would kind of share it with you, because I think the sentiment of respect and protect is still very much with us, even more so now. And just to kind of say, this was a quilt that I made with my colleague, who is a professor of microbiology at Manchester Metropolitan University, where I lecture. And she knew I'd done a lot of community projects. So she came to me around World AIDS Day and said, could we do something together? And this was the outcome. This is the last day. This is actually on World AIDS Day itself. So I did a number of workshops with different groups in Manchester, from some Manchester Mind, which is a mental health group. I went to a local high school. I did something at the Whitworth Art Gallery. So I devised and created the quilt, and basically it's red cross stitches and the red crosses, the red ribbons that are used for World AIDS Day. And it was just asking people to come and contribute. So it wasn't a kind of sort of organised thing in that I knew how many people were going to take part. It was very much, it happened very quickly. And this last day was done in the science building of Manchester Met. So it was a combination of Jo Verens, my colleague in microbiology, her science students, and some of my art students came over, and we just sat and stitched together. So I think it, you know, if you look at the detail of it, which you can't quite see on this, it was lovely because that thing of making a mark, the red cross stitches, people stitched in all different sort of ways and, you know, added their own mark to the quilt. And it was a lovely project. It kind of flowed, and, you know, we kind of finished it on the day and displayed it. And it's now, we gave it to the Terence Higgins Trust, the AIDS Trust in London. And it's on display in their headquarters in central London. So it kind of was, you know, given a good home. And yeah, it was just a lot of things to say about it, but I won't go into that now because there isn't time, but it's a nice project. Yeah.
Wonderful. Thank you, Lynn. And there is so much more to discover about Lynn's work through the Stitching Together website, but also elsewhere too, Lynn's own website. Amy, maybe we can put that in as well. Everybody's further sort of contact details, website details is also contained within the guidelines. So there are opportunities to follow up and find out more about all these projects featured here. So do take that up. Otherwise, Amy, I'll hand over to you now.
Okay, so now we're going to head to Rosa. And I have the, oh, wait a minute.
I know Rosa is here. I let Rosa in.
I'm here.
Great.
So Rosa, yeah, go for it. Would you like to tell us about your wonderful work featured on this page?
Yes, and I'll just share a couple of links to projects and things I will just mention really briefly.
Ah, lovely.
So, so that's shared in the chat. So my name is Rosa Tolnov Clausen, and I am from Denmark, but I am sitting in Finland right now, and I'm a PhD student at Gothenburg University in Sweden. And I'm educated as a textile designer, but since 2013, where I did a collaboration project with blind and visually impaired weavers in Denmark, I've basically been working with creating spaces for other people to weave. And the project that is featured on this photo, and which I will just speak really briefly about, is called The Weaving Kiosk. And it's a project that started based on three questions. It took place between 2017 to 18, and it's kind of still ongoing, but it is in development. The starting point for this project was whether I could attract a new and younger group of weaving practitioners in the Nordic countries, so Sweden, Denmark, Finland, Norway, Iceland, Faroe Islands, by making the craft available in terms of location, space, tools, and a weaving approach. And then I was also interested in whether the hand-woven product or garment could actually become a consumer alternative to the industrially produced product. So could young people between 25 and 45, could they think, I actually want to weave a bag instead of buying a bag if they have the possibility. And then I was also wondering whether such a kiosk could be a way to uphold the practical knowledge about weaving tradition in the North European countries. So basically a weaving kiosk is a public temporary space. It runs from 3 to 30 days. It can take place in basically any location. I've had 9 weaving kiosks, and some of them have been in closed offices, like where the employees have been on holiday, and I put in looms in empty storefronts, in galleries, in libraries, everything is possible. And then I work with a fashion designer, Merja Hannali Ulvinen from Finland, and she then designs products that people can either reproduce or they can make their completely own version of this product, choosing yarns, creating compositions, different combinations of bindings and decoration elements. But people can also make what they want. And I think that what has been very interesting for me to experience in this project is that there is an interest, like people want to participate. There's always been people, hundreds of people. And it's given some insight into how weaving can take place. And then I think particularly it's been really interesting to see that I can't control what people get from the space. So some people are interested in the production, but for other people, it's as much a place to be for a while. a place without any demands, to take a break or to have a creative outlet. And I think all of these additional meanings of the weaving space, that's really what excites me and also what my PhD research is about. So I took the weaving kiosk with me into the PhD, and now I'm figuring out how to continue. And I think with the guidelines, I think it can also be a resource in my teaching in Sweden, in Hudikovarland, at Gothenburg University, because I see that there is an interest by both MA and BA students in participatory practices. And then I think that I very much appreciate the very clear articulation that this is not a rule set, like that it is up for the reader to interpret and kind of lean towards this, but it's not telling you what to do. I think that's super important, working with people and participation. And then I was also thinking that I really think, like, one of the things that I've been missing in my practice has been more openness and sharing of success and failure. I think that it is really important to be able also to say, like, what did not go well. And maybe by having such a document, it's easier to start these conversations. Like, this was not so good, and I see now what could have been different. I see that with people I meet all over the world, that we share many experiences, but it's hard to find these experiences articulated. So that's some of the ways that I think this document can become really useful for me.
That's wonderful. Thank you, Rosa. Really, really interesting. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too, yes.
And really interesting to hear about your work. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so next on our wonderful tour of people's work, we have Sarah. Sarah, are you here?
Hello, I am.
Great.
Hi, everyone hear me okay? Great, okay. So thanks very much for having me. And yeah, like everyone said, it's really wonderful to be part of this network, and these guidelines are going to be so useful to so many of us. So really thrilled to be involved. Just a bit about this research project then. This is my PhD research, and it's based in Southeast Madagascar. So in this context, most women, their livelihood is weaving. So this is a traditional process from the ancestors. It's very spiritually important, using a reed called Mahampi. But these reeds are in decline. So in this context, there has been an NGO intervention to offer embroidery as an alternative livelihood and to train women in embroidery. And I've been involved in this intervention since the outset. This started in 2012. So by now, there is an independent embroidery cooperative run by 100 women. And they've all got really diverse embroidery practices. And whilst I was doing this work and working with these women, I started to think more and more about what that means to be a maker, how women experience the shift from a very ancestral, spiritually important practice where you make things that you use in everyday life towards a practice that was taught to you by someone from outside, where you produce things that are sold to people from outside and you don't use in your everyday life. So it kind of seemed appropriate to use a sort of making method because of the importance of crafts in the research. But there was also another kind of reason why making was really important, and that was in kind of overcoming expectation of what research is. So I think a lot of local people had an understanding, this is in Madagascar, of course, biodiversity is amazing, and local people had this understanding that research is what happens when people go to the forest and count lemurs and then go away again, and it's got nothing to do with us. We don't know what the outcome is. And then there's also this lots of NGO activity, and NGOs often do monitoring and evaluation, and I think participants can find this quite a sort of box-ticking exercise that's not meaningful at all. So I knew that to be important to both participants and relevant to participants and to myself, I needed to sort of distance myself from more traditional research methods, which is again why craft-based approach worked really well. So I ended up using various different approaches. I sit within a social science department within an international development department, but my background is in art and design. So I ended up drawing on a sort of hybrid of a more traditional anthropological approach and art and design and making perspectives. And I started off by doing a sort of traditional apprenticeship because I thought I can't answer this question without really engaging with this traditional craft. And that then gave me the skills to go and weave in the community, which is what you can see in this image here. I'm working with a very experienced weaver. And I was also, because I've got a background in embroidery, able to embroider with embroiderers. So then I could sort of talk to people all the way across this craft spectrum from weaving to embroidery whilst making. And these methods were, I thought they were going to be quite separate, but they ended up being quite sort of integrated and each fed the others. So I was also able to use drawing and making to sort of open a conversation between the different methods, if that makes sense. So when things weren't clear, my understandings of weaving weren't clear, I was able to then use drawing to clarify those and embroidery and discuss those weaving understandings with embroiderers. So it ended up being a really sort of integrated process. And I also made when I came home from the fieldwork as well. So making has been there all the way through from the fieldwork and right through the analysis as well. Yeah.
Thanks, Sarah, thank you. I'm conscious of time, but is there any final things that you wanted to?
Well, just in terms of the guidelines, Amy, one of the things that's fantastic, I think, is the sort of confidence that you can have as a researcher when you can refer to a document like this. Because one of the things that I found incredibly difficult is taking this transdisciplinary stance in a social science department and standing up and saying, right, embroidery is my method. Whereas actually I think these guidelines go a long way to really legitimize all the great work that's being done and provide a reference that we can all say, you know, this is real research when it's in a very traditional research context.
Yeah, wonderful. I always say that me and Emma referenced each other's PhDs. The only thing that we could find. So that's great to hear. Thank you so much, Sarah. Such interesting work. I'm sure, you know, really interesting to hear about. Thank you. Okay, I'm going to hand back over to Emma and I'm going to move the slide along. Okay.
And next up then we welcome Hinda Mandell, who has also joined us from the US. Hinda, would you like to talk about the project that you've contributed? Hinda, I know you're there. I've just...
Oh, sorry, I just had to unmute myself.
There you are. Hi, Hinda.
Hi, thank you, Emma. Thank you, Amy. Hi, everyone. I got involved in civic crafting in the last presidential election in 2016. So this... event, Corinthian Hall, a craft intervention is an outgrowth of that. The Corinthian Hall craft intervention was an ancillary program to an exhibition called Crafting Democracy. And I'm going to put a link in the chat to the craft intervention, which also takes you to the exhibition website. So I'm really interested in using textiles and crafting as a mechanism for marking unmarked historical places in my city of Rochester, New York. And Rochester is famous for two of its past residents, Susan B. Anthony, the famous American suffragist, and her colleague, Frederick Douglass, the famous abolitionist and the grandfather to the civil rights movement in the US. And so there's a parking lot in Rochester. It's the parking lot of the downtown Holiday Inn Hotel. And before this place was a parking lot, it was the site of Corinthian Hall, which was a gorgeous lecture hall and a site of social reform activity in mid 19th century Rochester. And the building was razed to the ground and became a parking lot in 1928. And it's remained a parking lot ever since. And Corinthian Hall is famous for these holiday abolitionist fundraising bazaars that the Rochester Ladies Anti-Slavery Sewing Society, which was founded in 1852 and did its work through the end of the American Civil War in 1868. They would hold these fundraising bazaars, and they would get these gorgeous, luscious, typically textile goods from England and Ireland, Scotland, and south of the American border, Mexico. And they would sell these foreign produced artisanal goods, and they would raise money for the abolitionist cause. So my collaborator, Julie Decker, and I, we put out a call for a knit or crochet or quilt swatches measuring 7 inches by 7 inches. And we got 150 people from across the US submitting 400 swatches. And we lined the railing and it was 100 feet long, decorating this kind of rusted parking lot railing. And you can't really see it here on the computer screen, but it's actually a cross stitch historic marker that says, on this site, since, 1852 were these, holiday bazaars that raised hundreds of dollars each year in helping freedom seekers, escaped enslaved people from the American South who were, escaping slavery to the North and onto Canada. So we were literally intervening in this space to mark the work of the Rochester Ladies Anti-Slavery Sewing Society.
Okay, Hinda, thank you so much for that brief glimpse into that project. One last very, very quick question. How might you make use of the guidelines?
So the number one thing that I want to do is I want to bring it into the classroom at RIT, the Rochester Institute of Technology, where I'm on faculty in the School of Communication. And I was supposed to teach a course this spring on civic crafting and social media. But unfortunately, due to COVID, all of our special topics courses got cut. But I was assured by my department chair that I will be able to teach that course. So that's going to be monumental, being able to offer this guide. As Sarah Brown was saying, it really professionalizes and legitimizes, I think, for students as well, especially students outside of textile fields, because I look at the rhetorical functions of craft. So for students who are in a liberal arts or a communication college, where I teach, this document is really central to be able to connect with them.
Thank you. That's great, Hinda. And again, really great to meet you as well as everybody else in person. Yes, let's say in person rather than over email. Thank you, Hinda. So Amy, I'll hand back over to you now.
Okay. I'm enjoying this, doing this double act with you, Emma.
Great.
Okay. So we're on to our last two amazing speakers. So we're going to go to Ma Rana, who I have seen on my screen somewhere.
Yes, hello, I'm here.
Yeah.
Thanks, Amy. Hi, Emma. Hi. So this is a frame from a short 5-minute film called One Day When We Were Young that I made with my mother. And it was part of an artist research in learning and teaching project that I ran with Fiona Hackney, who I know is in the room. So shout out to Fiona. So my mum was diagnosed with Alzheimer's in 2014. And actually crafting with my mother became a way of caring for her that was more than just doing ADLs, which stands for Activities for Daily Living, which is something that I guess sort of social care sort of focuses on as being, well, and it is kind of essential for sort of everyday needs. But also crafting with my mother was also about caring for myself as a dementia carer. So I was using crafting as both a therapeutic psychosocial intervention, but also as long-term dementia care. And I was working with what was there rather than focusing on what was lost. So in essence, crafting with my mother was employing an assets model rather than a deficits model. And often when you kind of read papers around Alzheimer's sort of dementia, there's often a focus on kind of burden and deficit. But I was interested in kind of exploring what was still there and what were sort of assets that could be built on. Just briefly, you know, from my experience, when you become a dementia carer, grieving sort of starts as an ongoing process for like a non-death loss. And so the first year of my mother's diagnosis, my way of dealing with it was trying to fix her, even though I knew I was setting myself up to fail. But I kept myself busy with this non-ending list of ADLs. And my mother was becoming increasingly a passive recipient of care. And so while I was kind of busy running around, switching off things, like making sure the central heating was on constant, finding missing keys, missing money, my missing mother, there were times when I did recognise that what my mother really wanted was for me just to be there, sat next to her. And I knew my mother was good at crafting, especially knitting and embroidery. So I set up a craft project, and I filmed us over a period of 1 month and edited the footage into a film. This called One Day When We Were Young. And at the end of this 5 minutes, I'll share the link in the chat. So crafting with my mother and filming us meant that I was able to look at her body beyond the sight of illness and instead pay attention to what was present and what I could uncover. And in a sense, maybe what she could kind of recover in herself. So my mother was able to kind of reconnect with herself, and she was agentic, and her hands were part of an effective kind of useful body rather than a body that was often a sort of the subject for medical inquiry or treatment. And I think through crafting with her, she was also able to experience herself as someone with skill and knowledge and the capacity of being able to do stuff. And what was great for me was that when I kind of set up this initial project, she kind of disrupted it within sort of 30 minutes and took over and kind of told me or suggested what the project could be. So I kind of ran with it and kind of developed the project with her. And what I kind of recognized was that in a world that was becoming increasingly disorientating for her because of the dementia, when she was knitting or doing embroidery, you know, she could be present and she could be calm in the moment, and her speech was kind of fluid and not repetitive, and she could be kind of exact in her movements, and her fingers were kind of fast and nimble. I mean, this film was in 2016, but she was still able to kind of embroider like this up till recently this year. I mean, she passed away in July, but a month before she passed away, she was still doing this sort of work. And I think for her, she was able to be proud of something, and I think that was important as well. So this film was a driver for a PhD that I'm doing in psychology at Birkbeck, which it's a qualitative study, and I'm using interpretive phenomenological analysis and video to explore the lived experiences of daughters caring for mothers diagnosed with Alzheimer's and asking them to craft together in their home. So kind of building on my sort of own lived experience. But also interestingly for me, about a month ago, I started work running art and craft workshops at a pain clinic in South London. And so actually this guideline is going to, it's kind of come at a timely moment. So, because I'm working for a pain clinic, I'm a key worker. So I'm actually running these during lockdown. I'm still able to run workshops, but only with three patients and following social distancing guidelines. And we're doing it in the pain clinic is in a GP practice. So I'm setting up in a GP waiting room. But also what's great already within the second week, like one of the participants, she's already kind of disrupted what I had planned. And I'm having to kind of rethink what I need to do, which is kind of not that you always want that to happen, but I think as long as you plan for it, you can just go with it and just kind of see where it takes you, because these women, people who come to the sessions, they have amazing skills. So it's kind of just tapping into the skill set that they have and sharing that and being part of that with them, which is really exciting.
Thank you, Ma. Thank you for sharing that. Such interesting work. And yeah, I'm glad that you're able to mention that new activity that you've got going on.
Mm.
And definitely that kind of needing to adapt in the moment to participants disrupting what you might have had planned. That was something that we tried to build into the guidelines, that, you know, you have to plan for your planning to go askew.
Absolutely.
Thing to write down, but definitely a really important idea. Thank you so much. Okay, and our final speaker is Lindy Richardson. Are you there?
I'm here. Can you hear me?
I can, yes.
Yay.
There you are. Hi. And yeah, we're very happy to have this beautiful image. It's the last page of the book. It just seemed like the perfect kind of celebratory, triumphant sort of closing to the publication. So please tell us about it.
Okay, so that image has become a bit iconic, actually. People keep asking me for it, to use it for all sorts of different things. And that is me right in the center there. And the joy that is on my face, absolutely 100%, does represent what I feel about textiles, what I feel about textile making, and what I feel about what has been a really long career in community textile making and working with others. And because we're not allowed, you know, we were told, guys, don't show any extra images because it's going to confuse everyone. So I cheated. And what I've got is I've got some books here. And this is the very first project that I ever worked on, which really inspired me, called Keeping Glasgow in Stitches in 1989, where a whole host of different artists were designing for a different month of the year. And we worked with all these community groups stitching designs that we'd done for this specific month of the year. But this project was in 2018. And it was part of a project that was a national project up and down the whole country to mark 100 years of women having the vote. It was set up by the now 1418, and it was produced by Artichoke. And I worked with three very diverse different groups of women. Interestingly enough, they all were women, and I was actually thinking, my goodness, I wonder how many men there are in this afternoon's discussion and this afternoon's participants. So it seems very fitting that it was all women. There was a group of staff from Edinburgh University, a group of students from Edinburgh University, and then a group of prisoners in the women's prison in Cornton Vale, in up in Stirlingshire. And we started off with discussions about women's rights to vote, and also at prisoners' rights to vote. And we did a little bit about, one of our earlier speakers talked about having the discussion at the start and having the discussion at the end. And we set up what we called responsive slogans. So each person came up with some kind of slogan or some kind of response to the discussion that we were having about equality, and particularly about equality for women. And each person was then given this disc, and they designed their responsive slogan to this question about women having the vote and about equality. And they stitched that onto their disc. And the disc came together, all these discs came together in this one big banner with that central slogan, which says, everyone is equal. And in a way that throws up lots of questions, and with all the Black Lives Matter and everything's happening round about us, it's made me really question that statement that we made. We made that statement in 2018. We didn't make that statement very recently. We made the statement in 2018. You'll see the students behind me, and the students are all wearing these big scale garments, and these big scale garments were almost like their personal banners and their personal statements. So you see the person just to my left, I'm dyspraxic, so I can never tell the difference between right and left, who says, smash the glass ceiling. There's one that says, do it anyway. They've all got these amazing big kind of like billboard embroidered shapes. And for me, the, one of the most important things that I'm doing is I am carrying a small banner. And that small banner was to present the women from the prison who were not allowed to vote and who could not come along to this procession. We're on our way marching to the Edinburgh procession, which was there was it was on in June 2018. And there was a procession in London. There was a procession in Cardiff. There was a procession in Northern Ireland. And we were in the Edinburgh procession. This is us walking to the march. And you can see how excited I am at that point. And we're only on the way to the march. So if you go and look at my Instagram, you will see the state that I got into when we actually got to the march. And we were given the honour of leading the Edinburgh March. We were all over the international newspapers. And one of the most exciting things for me was that the women in the prison were watching it live on the television. And I've got these lovely quotes. I've written quite a lot about this project. And I've got these lovely quotes. And one of my quotes that almost moved me to tears was, one of the women said, we were all sitting in, and they were allowed to sit in this specific area in the prison to watch it. And she said, we didn't think for a minute that we would see anything of our stuff. And she suddenly said, she jumped up and said, there's our banner. It's us. We're there. They can see us. And it was almost like we'd given these women this opportunity to make these statements to the world through textiles, through their own stitching. It was absolutely fantastic. And if you see any of the footage, you will always see that little orange flag with the Scottish Prison Service embroidered on it. And this idea that they were there in some shape or form. So yeah, it's lovely that this is kind of like finishing us off, and it's so joyous. And I've been doing this for so many years, and I can't tell you the pleasure that it's given me, the number of people that I hope that I have infected with my enthusiasm to stitch, and very much to stitch together. I stitch alone sometimes, and in lockdown just now, I'm doing lots of stitching alone, but I cannot tell you how much I yearn to get back to stitching with a broader group of people, to stitching round a big massive object, you know. So this idea of quilting and working in that community, all of these things are the things that give me energy, that energize me to want to keep spreading this word. Sometimes I describe myself as an embroidery evangelist. Everyone should be doing this. It gives us all so much pleasure. So yeah, thank you. And that's my timer saying, Lindy, you've talked for long enough. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. I think that what you've been doing is fantastic, and it's put into words a lot of the things that we've been doing for all these years. Thank you, everyone.
Oh, Lindy, well done. Thank you. I think you've definitely infected us all with your enthusiasm. So thank you so much. Okay, I'm going to stop sharing my screen. Okay, so Emma and I have a few things to say to kind of wrap up this section. So Emma, over to you.
That was a wonderful kind of cheer for times when hopefully we can all get back together and physically meet and make work together. So thank you for that, Lindy, a lovely place to stop with the speakers. So really it's down to Amy and I now just to wrap up this part of the afternoon session and say a huge thank you to all of the speakers for talking about such a widely varied range of uses of textile methods and techniques, but also groups that people are working with and the kind of motivations for doing it. I know there's so much more to explore there, so I would just ask all of you, look up all the links, find out more about these projects. Otherwise, back to the guidelines then, we are very excited to be launching the document today. The PDF is available to download from now. It's there. You can download it from the Stitching Together website. There is also a form where you can request hard copies. So here we have the print copy as well. So this is a limited run. But it's, you know, we want to have something physical in this digital world that we're now occupying as well. If you would like to request a hard copy, do fill in the form. We want to spread the word as far and as wide as we can. We have developed the document as Amy described, and our hope is that it is a useful tool for people who facilitate participatory textile making activities in all their various guises. These projects, as we've seen, are hugely diverse in the context, their motivations, the works that are produced from them, the techniques used, processes, and there is no right way of running these kinds of workshops. So as we've already mentioned, the guidelines are guidelines. They are not rules. We're by no means suggesting how these projects should be done. We want these to be used and adapted as appropriate for the particular projects that people might have in mind. We're all aware of this, but very important to underline it. Making textiles, whether that's stitching, knitting, crocheting, embroidering, these are very familiar activities to many people, and they can be very accessible as well to many different groups of people. But they do carry deep cultural and political associations. We must be aware of that. We really hope that the guidelines can support, you know, an inclusive and anti-discriminatory ethos in these practices. So on that note, this document is not set in stone. We do very much see it as a foundation from which to grow new projects, you know, challenge some of the experiences that we've had, adapt the ideas, come up with new ones, renew the approaches suggested, and we'd be interested to know how they're being used. So do get in touch. Please tell us how you're using these guidelines. We'd really welcome suggestions, feedback, and additional examples to continue to build on this work that we've begun. So, Amy.
Yeah, okay, I'm just bringing up the website again.
Great.
Just to finish off with just a final few words about the network, because we're conscious that we have such an amazing group of people, some of whom might not have known about the Stitching Together network previously. So as well as launching the guidelines, we want to make sure to tell you about the network and that you feel kind of welcome to get involved and join. So basically anyone with interests in this area, the only qualification for entry is that you have an interest in participatory textile making, and you're very welcome to join us. So what that means is just sending us a short profile and an image to go on the website on the network members page, and then you can join our mailing list to be in touch with other members and share opportunities, news, challenges, problems, ideas, whatever. There's also opportunities to write, you could write a case study of a workshop or a project to share them with others on the website. And there's a really great collection of those already. We invite people to write guest blog posts about particular kind of issues or challenges that they might like to share. And finally, if this whistle stop tour has left you wanting more, it's left me wanting more, we are planning a bigger event for next spring, which will be sort of the end of our funded period of the network. But I have no doubt that the network will continue beyond kind of the period of our specific funding. So we are planning this bigger event for the spring, where we should have more time to hear about the wonderful work that people are doing, and more time for discussion. So for all of that, if you keep an eye on the website and follow our Twitter account, which is shown there, that'll enable us to all keep in touch and kind of continue this amazing event of all coming together. So my notes say end of the official bit.